Thank you for listening to Data Science at Home podcast with Francesco Gadaleta. You are about to get cutting-edge insights from the people who are reshaping the world of technology with machine learning, data science, and artificial intelligence. It's time for Data Science at Home. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for tuning in and welcome to another episode of Data Science at Home podcast. I'm your host, Francesco, podcasting from the cozy office of my company, Amethix Technologies, where we use machine learning and artificial intelligence to empower people and organizations. Today, I'm not alone. In fact, I'm with Jadil de Armas, senior software engineer at Disney and author of VideoFlow, a Python framework that facilitates the quick development of complex video analysis applications and other serious processing-based applications in a multi-processing environment. That's a lot of words, I know. I've inspected the repository on GitHub and some of the capabilities of this framework, and I must say that it's really, really interesting. So stay with us because Jadil is going to tell us a lot more than what you can read from the GitHub repo. Hi, Jadil. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Francesco, for having me here. Yes, I am very happy, and I'm sorry for the long description to VideoFlow.
That's cool. I mean, we all need to explain more than less. So, Jadil, could you please introduce yourself to the listeners of Data Science at Home?
Yes. So I am Jadil. I work for Disney. I have been doing this for at least 5 years working at Disney. I am a very young guy. I came to the US a while ago. I was born in Cuba. I studied math and computer science. And after doing that bachelor's degree, I went to grad school. And then I came here to live in Florida and to work for Disney after, you know, a couple of experiences at Bloomberg in New York and other places.
Cool. And so now you're based in Florida. In fact, you are based in Orlando, where I was, in fact, 1 year ago.
Yes, that's correct.
Small world. So when did you start doing data science?
So back in 2009, in school, I had a research opportunity, a summer research opportunity at another school. And this research was about information retrieval and natural language processing. And that opportunity was great for me. It opened my world to data science and to machine learning and artificial intelligence. And since then, I haven't done much outside of data science.
Interesting. So what exactly do you do at Disney, if you can, of course, talk about some of your work?
Yeah, I cannot say too much, but I think I can say enough. So we work in solving interesting problems. The team is called Emerging Tech, so the name says a lot about it. I have been working in problems related to natural language processing, but mostly computer vision. And in computer vision, we work in object detection and segmentation, object tracking, imaging painting. I cannot say too much about it, but let's say that we are very interested in detecting human actions and behaviors in video. And also we are trying to use computer vision for augmented reality, because augmented reality is a big push inside the company too.
I see. And so now let's move a bit to VideoFlow, which is your most recent work, if I'm not wrong. And it also gained the attention of the community of data scientists, in particular those interested in computer vision. So what is VideoFlow?
So VideoFlow belongs to the engineering side of data science. It allows the end user to compose computational flows to process and to analyze live video streams in real time. Most of the time, obviously, these computations are machine learning models. So it is great for applications such as object tracking, action detection, crowd movement analysis, or any kind of problem that you can attack it using a composition of computations that can be expressed as a directed acyclic graph, where the nodes obviously represent the computations and the edges in the graph represent the dependencies between or among those computations.
So this is pretty much in line with what the folks at TensorFlow have been doing, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, yes. TensorFlow also uses the directed acyclic graph express, you know, the model of expressing computations as a directed acyclic graph, because it's very expressive. It lets you accomplish a lot of things, a lot of flexibility.
I mean, likewise for Dask, I guess, and also Spark jobs, all you know, things that use the same concept behind the computational complexity. So what?
Yes.
So why did you create the video flow? And is there any particular, let's say, painful problem that it solves?
Yes, it's you know, the engineering side of video processing is not a fun part. It's not the fun side. It gets complex, especially when you need to process a video on real time. When you have a process that have multiple models and dependencies between them, and on top of that you need to process the video on real time. And obviously these computations, you need to coordinate between them. And that is something that is not completely trivial, so it has got to be done. And usually data scientists, they don't have the skill set to do this, because they want to stay focused on the data science side of it. So this resolves that issue for them. And the other thing that I have noticed is, you know, sometimes the models are slow, so you have bottlenecks in your flow. You want to process a video at 30 frames per second, but your pipeline only can process it at 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 frames per second. So you have got to add parallelism to your process, and coordinating with parallelism also is another thing that you need to do, and video flow takes care of all these things for you.
It's true. I mean, I agree with you when you say that data scientists are not really data engineers, and, you know, they want to take care of the model aspect, the modeling aspect, you know, forgetting about the rest. So it's always good to have tools like the one you created that indeed fills that gap. Now, you know, when you say you have like 30 FPS, 30 frames per second in a, I would say, a regular video now, not even a high definition one, am I right?
That's correct. High definition, I think, is 60.
Exactly. So if you have, you know, 30 FPS is already one order of magnitude higher than what, you know, a trivial machine learning model can process. So how do you solve? I mean, I'm not asking you the technical details of how is it possible to solve these things, but in fact, you need a lot of parallelization there. Yeah, am I right?
Yeah, that's correct. That's correct. So, you know, one way to solve it is get a cheaper model, but sometimes that's not an option. You have got to add parallelization. So what you do is, hey, we have four GPUs, for example, available. We have some other CPUs, and you want to run in parallel. One option is to do it in a round-robin fashion. Hey, in a round-robin way, let's distribute the task of frames, and that way you keep the order of the video. But that's not the most optimal option, because your GPUs might be running at different speeds. That means that one of them will be waiting while the other finishes. So this is the best way, the optimal way to do it. You know, every GPU should be working all the time, non-stop. They cannot be your bottleneck here. So that's what you do. You have a queue, an input queue, where the GPUs are reading from that queue. And that's all they do. Each GPU lives in a different process, and each GPU has an independent output queue. But they all read from the same queue. And they just read from there. They read, they process, they write to the output queue, and they go back and read, process, write, nonstop. Now, the problem here is, how do you order those outputs from those GPUs? That's the trick here, because they are working at their own speed. They are not caring about order. So what you do is, you have a different queue that is called an ordering queue. And then every time a GPU reads from the input queue, that GPU needs to register in the ordering queue from what frame it read, and it places in that ordering queue, and then it continues processing. So now when you want to reorder all this processing, you just go to the ordering queue and you read it in order. And that ordering queue tells you from what output queue read the next frame that you need to reorder your processes, your stream of video. So, you know, it's better with a diagram, but I think that's the best I can do over audio. So
yeah, no, but I want to point out that this is not a trivial problem, because you know, if you want to parallelize on video frames, you know, that would be trivial if the video frames were all independent from each other, right?
That's correct.
So you would just distribute them across all the GPUs that you have available, and that's fine. Problem is that you have to maintain a time consistency, and so they are depend, you know, each frame depends on the previous frame or previous frames.
Yeah, you need to keep the order of what's going on here. You cannot lose
right.
it at all.
And so that's where the major of the complexity comes from.
Yeah.
Cool. So is there a third problem that you solve with, like, what are the three issues, the three problems that you solved with VideoFlow then, if you want to summarize for our listeners?
Yes. So synchronizing the dependencies that you have in the graph of computation. The second issue that we solve is parallelization over a stream of videos when you need to keep the order. We do this seamlessly, and that's a great thing. The other problem that we don't solve, but that, you know, we are trying to solve, is it has to do with accuracy and optimization. An automated, suppose you have a bottleneck, how do we automatically remove it? You know, you have resources, you have computational resources, you have an accuracy target that you want to reach, and you have a speed that you want to reach. You want to reach 30 frames per second at a given accuracy with a given computational resources. Is that possible? VideoFlow should be able to do that for you automatically. And that's the third problem that we don't solve yet, but we are very close to solve.
This is very interesting, because in fact, you can fix a variable and see what VideoFlow gives you for the other two. You have kind of 3 degrees of freedom in your problem. And so VideoFlow supports you in deciding what the accuracy that you should expect with this or that resources, or with this or that FPS support.
Exactly. Nice. Yeah. So, you know, it cannot do magic. If your model doesn't go higher than 90% accuracy, we cannot get it better than that. But if you have a model at 90% accuracy and you have a model at 80% accuracy, obviously there is this trade-off in the computer vision community, in the models, that usually the more accurate models are the slowest ones.
Sure.
So you need more computational resources for that.
Of course.
But VideoFlow should be able to, hey, we have this accurate model, but I need to process at 30 frames per second. What kind of computational resources do I need to get me there? And VideoFlow can do that.
Nice. I'm pretty curious about some, you know, real numbers. For example, given an object tracking model, this can be whatever. I'm just mentioning something that comes up to my mind right now. Now, imagine you have an object tracking model at Disney and a video stream at, let's say, 30 FPS. So what type of hardware would you need to process, for example, with 100% accuracy and no missed tracked objects?
Got it. Okay. I don't know if I can give you 100% accuracy, but let's, let's work with the example. Let's go for it. So you have 30 frames per second. Let's assume now that you have a model that is very accurate, and but because it's very accurate, it's a little bit slow, and you can work only at, let's say, 10 frames per second. Mm-hmm. On a GPU, that same model running in the CPU give you about 1 to 2 frames per second. Let's pick two frames per second. So now you have to reach 30 frames per second. You have the model at 10 frames per second. VideoFlow will, and you have 2 GPUs in your system. This is what VideoFlow will do. VideoFlow will allocate that model to the 2 GPUs, and it will allocate it also into 5 cores of your CPUs, which is possible. GPU machines have a lot of cores. So you have now 7 models allocated into 7 different processes, and that gives you the 30 frames per second that you need. You are getting 20 frames per second from the models allocated in your GPU, and you are getting 10 frames per second from the 5 models allocated to your CPUs, working in parallel and scaling linearly. And there is, you know, that assumption is correct. There is not much overhead in the scaling here. With VideoFlow, it should scale very linear as you keep adding processes to your pool of processing.
Sure. Well, the only thing is probably the pressure on memory, since you will have to copy the memory, and you know, every process will live in its own.
Yes, you definitely need a big machine. Yeah. and for these things.
Yeah. Okay. Well, but RAM is cheaper and cheaper now, so.
Yep.
Okay, what are some of the peculiarities of this library? Can you summarize the high-level architecture? I know that it's not, you know, it's not easy on a podcast. It's much easier with a diagram. Probably there is some in your repo, in your README markdown description. So how, you know, how does it work on a very high level? And if you guys have a roadmap, or what's the future of VideoFlow?
Yes, of course. So this is how it works right now. You define your flow in source code as a graph. Then VideoFlow will compute a topological sort of that graph. And that topological sort is passed to an execution engine. That execution engine up each node in your computation graph around as a task, and it will create queues for communication between the tasks. We mentioned queues already when we were talking about the parallelism mm-hmm. that is needed. So it creates the communication queues and all the synchronization that is needed, and then it will allocate each task to run as an independent process. The tasks that it can allocate to the GPUs will allocate them to the GPUs. When it runs out of GPUs, then it will start using the CPUs in the machine. And it's smart, it knows what you know, it will allocate the most computational expensive tasks into to the GPUs as possible. And then all the coordination between tasks is done using queues, logs, and semaphores. And then obviously when you define the flow, you have three types of nodes in that flow. And this is something natural from the application side point of view. You have producers, processors, and consumers. And your producers are the sources of the flow. They are the ones that generate the data to place in the flow, like they read from a video stream or from a Kafka queue or from a file, and they place that data into the flow. Then you have the processor nodes that will be doing the heavy lifting and the computations, and they just simply get input and return output and place it in the queues, and the queues take care of, there is another system that takes care of the synchronization and taking that data where it needs to go. And then you have the consumer nodes, and they just consume the data. They are the sinks of the graph. They have no children. They simply get the results of the computation and they store them somewhere. So, you know, those are the big highlights of how the system works.
And so what's the current version? It's 0.2?
Yeah, so regarding versioning, we are at 0.2.2. That's okay. A very low number, but we are we have a roadmap all the way to 1.0. Starting from 0.3, we are adding a couple of more models to the framework. We are automating this thing that I talked to you about, automating the detection of bottlenecks and automating the resource allocation even better for more complex situations that is coming up. The reporting and visualization of your flow, this is something very important because you want to visualize what is going on. You don't want to just read the logs in your flow of what's going on. So we are going to implement a visualization, like TensorBoard for TensorFlow, a visualization thing also, so you can visualize how your flow is running, where are the bottlenecks, etc. And then after version 1.0, we are going to go the distributed way. We want to just not implement VideoFlow for a multiprocessing environment. We want to use it in a cluster of machines.
How many people are involved with this? I mean, I know it's open source, so it's always difficult to count how many developers are involved, but do you have, let's say, fixed-time developers next to you?
I don't have that luxury yet. We have, obviously, at work, we have me and a couple of other co-workers. We are working on it in our free time whenever we can. My free time is a lot because I'm giving a lot to the library. So I have, and those other two people are also pretty involved in it. And also, we have the community. We have a couple of people that have been putting some changes into it too from outside of the company. But, you know, contributions are always welcome. And the first contribution that people can do is just use it and see how they like it.
Exactly. And indeed, we will report the repository in the show notes of this episode. So even the large community of data science at home can enjoy and eventually participate to the or contribute to the development for sure. Speaking about the models, which models did you include in the library so far?
You know, you can bring your own models into the library, but also the library has models that you can use from off the shelf without having to do too much. We have classification, we have object detection, we have object segmentation, and we have human pose estimation. And these models, all of them have been trained either using the COCO dataset or the Open Images dataset that was published by Google recently.
Well, does it depend also on TensorFlow, or can it abstract from that?
Okay, so all the models that we have implemented, those that I just mentioned to you, we are using TensorFlow for them. That doesn't mean that you cannot bring your own deep learning preferred library into the mix, because all you have to do is wrap your code and wrap your library around a processor interface, and you should be good to go. Obviously, you would have to do a little bit of more, probably add 30 more lines of code than what you would need to do with TensorFlow, but after that, once you have done it once, you don't have to repeat it. So, sure. Yeah, it's in that sense, it's a deep learning library agnostic.
What are the biggest challenges with video analysis? I mean, I know that it's a very long story there. There is a lot of research going on. But if you want to summarize, you know, the two biggest challenges that you have seen so far with computer vision, and in particular, video analytics.
The first thing that happens with video is that video adds a time dimension. And that time dimension is the one that will cause you all the trouble. On the engineering side, you want to do real-time video analysis. And as we have mentioned, this is a challenge because you need powerful computing power to achieve this. On the other hand, computations in powerful servers in the cloud is not the optimal way of doing things, because you should compute close to the edge, close to where the video is coming from, is possible, because you don't want to overload your network with video. So you have these two interests fighting each other there. You need a lot of computing power, but you also should compute as close to the edge as possible. So for the engineering side, that's, I believe, the biggest challenge that you have got with video. Now, on the modeling side, time also adds the problem here. And the problem here is time coherence. Time coherence is a big problem. When we watch a video, we automatically, if there is a little bit of jumping going on, we see it, the brain sees it, even if it's very little. So when you build a model for video processing, for example, a segmentation model, the segmentation model usually treats all the frames independently. It gives you the segmentation for this frame, and then for the next frame, it gives you another segmentation. These two frames are related by time, but the model doesn't know it. The model just outputs a segmentation mask that you can use somewhere else, but that segmentation mask is usually not coherent with the previous one. So that's time coherence is a big challenge for video analysis, especially from the modeling side of it.
So you have mentioned already that you guys are moving towards version 1, which will be, I guess, a big improvement. But what VideoFlow still doesn't solve, like at this date?
Yeah, first of all, VideoFlow does not work in a distributed environment with multiple machines. That's one thing that we want to solve. So also VideoFlow right now, at this moment, does not self-adapt to changing computational demands in the flow, something that we will visit around very soon. Right now, if you know, at some point you are receiving a little bit more load of processing that you need to do, you have got to stop the flow and restart it with more computational resources. And this is not optimal, so we obviously want to solve this as soon as possible. And mostly, you know, there are other things that are a little bit more complex that we want to solve, but these two, I think, are pressing things that are not there but should be there already.
So, in fact, you guys want to insert something called, you know, the cold start, basically.
Yep, that's correct.
Now, Khadil, it's time for the philosophical question, something that I ask to everyone at the end of the interview. is like, you know, about the future of AI and about the future of machine learning. So my question for you is, what domains you expect practitioners will focus in the next, let's say, 5 years from now?
Got it. This is a very broad question. I will talk about computer vision, if that is okay with you. And I know there is no right or wrong answer, and we are not prophets, so we cannot predict the future. So whatever I say, don't put your money in the bank because of it. But something that I have noticed in practice is that making smaller models is very important right now, and people are focusing on that because we want to run the models in edge devices, in phones. We want to run them everywhere. So making smaller models that are as accurate as the big models that we have right now is an active area of research that I believe will keep moving a lot. So image synthesis and generation is also a very hot topic. Video synthesis and generation is obviously more difficult because of what we talk about, the time coherence problems. But it's also that, you know, it's something that people will focus on too. In robotics, I see a lot of integration between vision, sound, and touch for a better understanding of what is going on. For example, if you want to do a picking robot to pick fruits from trees, it's not just vision. You want to add touch to know if the fruit is ready for picking and other things. So it's a very interesting problem.
Right. So if you speak for yourself, like, what's the you know, the problem that you think you will be focusing in the future or in the next few months or years?
I want to answer this question in something related to video flow, obviously, because it's something that I have noticed in my own practice of computer vision. A problem that I see coming time after time is the following, is that for most real-world tasks, there is not a large-scale labeled data set to help solving that problem. For example, let me explain with examples. So we have data sets for human pose estimation. We have data sets annotated already for detecting cars or detecting humans in a video. But we don't have large-scale data sets for things like this. Suppose that now people interact with cars, and you want to detect in a video stream, you want to detect when people are pushing cars, or when people are getting into cars, or when people are exiting cars, or being hit by cars, or placing objects in the car trunk. We don't have annotated data sets with all these actions in video, and I don't think it will be possible because the different kind of actions that you can think on how a person interacts with an object is almost infinite. So to solve these kind of problems, you have to use composition of models. You have to figure out, hey, what models can I use and what models can I compose together to detect these kind of actions? We obviously have our own intuition of how we solve these kind of problems, but I believe that if we find fully computational approach to discover the relationship between different visual tasks and what composition of tasks are better to solve certain kind of problems, this will be very useful because, you know, when you have model-aware relationships among different visual tasks, this will demand less supervision, it will use less computation, and it will behave in more predictable ways. And this is very important, predictability, especially if you are doing science, you want to be able to predict what is going on.
Well, I would add that, you know, in fact, you are talking about model composition and so hyper-specialized models, where each model is indeed specialized in recognizing or predicting some specific task, and then compose these models all together in order to get a much more, you know, sophisticated predictor at a more abstract level, right?
That's correct. You got it right.
Yeah. So this is something that I've been reading for a while, and it's very interesting. I mean, there is a lot of research going on, of course, and I think that such a model, as you said, indeed will demand, you know, will use less computation, but also will demand much less data, I think, and probably, you know, because I hope we will never have enough data sets for people who get hit by cars, because that means that something bad is happening.
Yes, right? That's correct. The data is king, and data availability of lack of it is, I think, is the main issue that is driving this research.
I totally agree with you, Gadil. And that was really cool. It was very nice having you on the show. I'm sure that the listeners of Data Science at Home appreciate your framework, VideoFlow. The coordinates of the repository of GitHub will be reported in the show notes of this episode. And definitely, I appreciated a lot your time to share VideoFlow in this episode. Thank you very much.
No, you're welcome, and thank you for having me in the show and giving me the opportunity to talk about the library and what I think is very cool.
Sure thing. Ciao.
Ciao. Bye.
You've been listening to Data Science at Home podcast. Be sure to subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, or Podbean to get new fresh episodes. For more, please follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, or visit our website at datascienceathome.com.